Hello everyone. My name is Havish Madhupati. I'm the founder of Havish M Consulting. I'm a Microsoft Certified Office Master, a Microsoft Certified Expert, a Microsoft Partner, a Microsoft Certified Data Analyst Associate, and a Microsoft Certified Trainer. I have been working on Excel for 20 plus years now, and I've also authored 18 books on analytics. In this video, I'm going to talk to you about Power Pivot, Power Query, and then some basic design and charting and dashboard creation on pivot tables. This video is going to be a little long, so please brace up. You're going to learn a lot. A lot of topics might be completely new to you, but I'm very, very confident that you will learn immensely and benefit immensely after watching this video. This is the problem statement that we have. I have sales for 4 years, 2013, 14, 15, and 16, in four separate workbooks. I'll just open the first one so that you can see what data is here. It's a very simple, clean data set. We'll have about 2000 rows, the order date, the shipping date, shipping mode, customer ID, segment, city, state, region, subcategory, sales, quantity, and profit. Similarly, we have data for the three other years as well, 2014, 2015, and 2016. The number of columns and the order of columns are the same, but of course the number of rows might differ from year to year. While I keep this Excel file open, I would also like to show you that there are some other dimension files that we have. We have budget, we have the category, ID and name, and the target. Let me open the first one. So if you look at the original data, we only have the subcategories with us, so paper, labels, storage, so on and so forth. And in our category Excel, you would notice we only have category and subcategory. So this basically is the mapping that we have. So let me just sort it like this so that you can understand it better. So we have three categories: furniture, office supplies, technology, and then we have 17 subcategories within them. So remember, in our original data, we have 17 subcategories that have been purchased multiple times. Now, usually we would have done a VLOOKUP or an XLOOKUP or an index match, but I don't want to do that. Why? Because that would require me to do manual work. Also, I will have to do that manual work on all the 4 years separately. So this is the first problem. We want to get the categories in our data set as well. If you look at the next Excel, we have our ID and name. Similar problem to the previous one. Here we have 793 unique customer IDs and the corresponding name. And in our sales data, we only have the customer ID with us. We don't know who this person is. So if we want to search for DP13000, we will have to come here and then do a VLOOKUP to find out that the person is Darren Paz. Then we have the budget. The budget is a cross tableau data. So we have the 12 months and we have the 4 years and we have the budget like this. Now, as you can see, this is a cross tableau, or in Excel, what we call a pivoted data set. The format is not incorrect. It's just that if we want to connect this to our sales data, we might have to make a few changes to this. And the final file that we have is the target, which is the next year target for all the four regions and all the three categories. So, for example, if Central has done, let us say, 100,000 in year one, then the target for year two would become 100,000 into 1.3 for the office supplies category. For furniture, it would be 1.4, and for technology, it would be 1.3, like this. Excellent. So now that we have seen the data, let's start working with it. Now, the very first thing that I want to do is to save my Excel file. Remember, this is a new Excel file that I've created. I'm just going to save this on my desktop and call this solution. The absolute first thing we want to do is to take all the four Excels which have the transactional sales data from 13, 14, 15, 16, and then combine it into one single data set. To do this, we click on Data, Get Data, From File, and then From Folder. Now we can select the folder path, which is Superstore and Sales. The first thing that Excel will do here is to confirm how many files are there in that folder. So as you can see, it is confirming that we have four files, 2013, 14, 15, and 16. We want to combine and transform the data set. The moment we tell Excel that we want to combine all these four Excel files, it is now going to confirm with us which sheet do we want to combine. Now, in my current problem, we only have one sheet with us, which is called Sheet 1. So we can click on that sheet and then press OK. The moment you click on OK, there is a new window that will open up. And this window is called the Power Query Editor. Remember, the same Power Query Editor is also available on Power BI. It works exactly the same. How do we know whether the four Excel files have been added or not? If you look at the first column called source.name, you would see here that we have 2013, 14, 15, and 16. And very neatly, all these four Excel files have been combined into one single file. Excellent, right? Click on OK and then select Close and Load in the top left corner. So now that the four Excel files have been combined, they will be pasted as a single file, as a sheet on our current workbook. I'm just going to change this to my sales data. This is my table of content. And I'm going to call this. Okay, there's nothing here, so we can delete it. And this is my intro. So as you can see, we only have one single file with us, which is sales. And here we have data from 2013 all the way up till 2016. Now remember, if you add any more files in the same folder, for example, I'm just going to copy and paste 2016 and call this 2017. When we go back, right click and refresh, you would see that in one click instantaneously, 2017 has also got picked up. Similarly, if you go back to the folder and you delete 2017 and you right click and refresh, same thing, in one click instantaneously, 2017 is removed from the combined file. Excellent. So we have the sales data with us. Now we need to take up the customer names and the categories. So we can take it in any order that we want. Let's go to Data, Get Data, From File, and then From Workbook. I want to select ID and name and then click on Import. A very common problem that you would see here is that the column headings don't come properly. This is not difficult to fix, But just something that you have to observe. Remember, do not click on load directly because the column headings are not correct. The column headings should be customer ID and name, not column 1 and column 2. Let's click on transform data. This will take us back to Power Query editor. And here we can see that we have two queries with us. So we have the first one, which is sales. I'm just going to call this fact underscore sales because it's a fact table. And the other one I can call as dim underscore name. To make sure that customer ID and name becomes the column header, we click on use first row as headers, and immediately customer ID and name will become the headers. Let's close and load. And we will get another sheet. Let's call this the customer name. Similarly, we can click on data, get data from file, from workbook, and then select our category. Select the sheet, click on transform data. This time we have to make two changes. Number one, we have to make sure that the headers are correct, so category and subcategory. To do this, we click on use first row as headers. And then to fill up all these blank values, right click on the first column and then fill down. This looks great. Let's click on close and load. And let's call this our category. Once more, we click on data, get data, from file, and then from workbook. We want to select our budget this time. Now, this file requires a little bit of work to be done. Since the format is a cross-tabular format, we have to make sure that this gets converted into a tabular format. Like earlier, the first thing we want to do is to click on first row as headers. And then we want to right-click on the first column and say, unpivot all the other columns. What will happen is that since we have the month of January for all the 4 years, 13, 14, 15, 16, rather than showing the data in four different columns, we want to see the data in four different records like this. But we want to combine month and attribute, and let's understand why this is very important. Okay, let me change this to my dimension category, and this one can be changed to my dimension and budget. Now see, we have to combine the month and the year. The reason is because in our data, we have the order date. The problem is that our order date is for every single date. So we have the 3rd of January, 4th of January, 5th and 6th and so on and so forth. But the problem is that the budget is not for a day-wise level, obviously. So we don't have the budget for every single date. We only have it for the entire month. So we might have to make an additional column on both the budget and the sales data set. On the budget data set, we want to combine the month and the year. To do this, we click on add column and then column from examples. And now we can give a sample. So I can say 1st of January 2013. So if you notice, Power Query is trying to understand what is it that we want as a result, even though the results are not 100% correct. So we give one more sample, 1st of January 2014, and you notice all the results are correct like this. Let's click on OK. Once we get the 1st of January 2013, we can click on the ABC icon and then change it to a date format. Now we don't need the first two columns, so to avoid any confusion, I want to remove the first two columns. But this is only giving me the first date of every month. Similarly, in the sales dataset as well, we need to get the first date of every month. To do this, we select the order date column, click on add column, then date, and then select month and start of the month. So this will create a new column called the start of the month. Why have we done this? Because now the start of month can be connected via a relationship to the merged column that we have created. Let's also call this the month. Close and load. And now we get another sheet. Let's call the sheet the budget. Wonderful. Now we want to connect to the last Excel file that we have, which is the target. Once again, data, get data from file and from workbook. We want to select the target. And now I can select the sheet, click on transform data. Just like last time, we want to first rename this to dem underscore target. And now we want to right click and then unpivot all the other columns. And let's call this the target. And this can become the sub, no, this is the category. Okay, let's try and understand. Now this is the next year target that we have. We want to multiply this number 1.3 with the sales value that we have to get the target for the next year. But this is based on two things. This is based on the region and the category. For example, if you look at the first record, our region is central and our category is, so our region is central and our category is, remember our subcategory is paper, so our category would become office supplies. And if you look at the target for central and office supplies, the target is 1.3. This means that this number that you see, the achievement for 16.448, this should become 16.448 into 1.3. How do you do that? So we want to select our sales data set and multiply that by this number 16.448. But remember, we only want to do this for the latest year that we have, that means for 2016, so that we can set a target for 2017 as well. So we will come to that in a bit. The first thing we want to do is to double check whether all the queries are coming in the right places or not. So we have the fact table, that is sales. We have the dimension, which is a name. Another dimension, that is the category. A third dimension, that is the budget. And then we have the fourth dimension, that is the target. So if we want to get these numbers, 1.3, 1.4, 1.1, and 1.2, in the sales table, we will have to do a merge. So we click on home and then select merge queries. And now we can merge the current table, that is the fact sales table, with the target dimension. Now remember, this is not a match between one column each, it's a match between two columns. So we will select the region, press Ctrl and select the category. But if you notice here, we don't have a category, which means that we first have to get the category in the sales table. So we click on merge. We select the category table and we can simply click on subcategory and click on subcategory. It uses a left outer join and it says that every single subcategory has been found to have a corresponding category. Click on OK. This will bring the entire category table and add it to the sales data set. Click on expand and then select what we need, which is the category. Let's call this the category. Let's just move it a little bit so that it comes next to our subcategory. Once we have done this, we can again click on merge. And now because we have both the region and the category with us, we can select the target, click on region, press Ctrl, select the category. We can select region, press Ctrl, and then select the subcategory. Sorry, the category. So 1 and 2 and 1 and 2. It says all the matches have been found. And when you click on OK, the target table will come. We can expand, and since we're only interested in the target, we can click on the next year target and press OK. Now we want to multiply this number with the sales amount. So add column, custom column, and we can call this 2017 target. And in 2017 target, we can simply write the target next year multiplied by the sales amount. Now do remember, the calculation is going to happen for every single year, which we don't really want. We just want to see the target for 2017. That means that whenever the year is 2016, the target should be created. Otherwise, it should be a blank. To do this, we can click on add column and then conditional column. And we will see that if the year is 2016, then we want to see the target. Otherwise, we don't want to see the target, right? But the problem is that we don't have a column which have the years in it. So we will select the order date, and on add column, we can click on date and then get the year. So this will give us all the years. When we have all the years, we can now click on conditional column and say that if the year is equal to 2016, then the output should be from the column, which is the 2017 target. Otherwise, the value should be blank, or let me put a zero here. So you notice we get another column that has zeros everywhere, but you notice when we click on, or rather when we select 2016, in fact, let me just scroll back up and then sort the data. That would be easier. So let me just show you that for 2013, 14, 15, it is going to show us a zero. But for 2016, it is going to show us the target like this. Excellent, right? Let's cancel the last step. And we don't really need all these intermediary steps now. So we can click on the year and then remove it. We can also select the 2017 target and then remove it. As a matter of fact, we don't even need the target multiplier, so we can remove this as well. Excellent. Now we can click on क्लोज एंड लोड, वी हैव अनदर शीट, दिस इज आवर टारगेट शीट, इवन दो वी डोंट रियली रिक्वायर दिस, आई विल स्टिल लेट इट बी हेयर. सो नाउ वी हैव फिनिश्ड आवर वर्क विथ पावर क्वेरी एंड एज यू कैन सी वी हैव ऑल द क्वेरीज हेयर, सो आवर फैक्ट टेबल, आवर डायमेंशन टेबल्स एज वेल. What we need to do now is to add these output from Power Query to the data model. So if you notice, I have a tab called Power Pivot, and Power Pivot will help us to manage the data model. If you don't see the Power Pivot tab on your Excel file, simply click on File, then select Options, click on Add-ins, select the second option, which is COM add-ins, these are component add-ins, and click on Go. Once you do this, there would be an option called Power Pivot that you will have to enable. So one by one, I will click on Budget and then add it to the data model. So when you add it to the data model, there is a window that will open up. This is called the Power Pivot window. No need to worry about this for now. Simply close this and make sure that you select all the other tables and you're adding it to the data model. So this is our category. Then we have our customer name. You know what? Before we put the customer name table in Power Pivot, I want to make sure that these names are correct. So if you notice, the names currently are surname comma first name. So right click table and edit query, and we want to make sure that this is the first name and then the last name. So like we had done earlier, we can click on add column and column from examples, and we can give a sample explaining to Power Query that this should be Darren Pass and this should be Filena Ober. So we get all the names here. Let's click on OK. Let me remove this one. We don't need this anymore. And we can call this the name. Perfect. Click on Home, close and load. And now all the names have been fixed. Now we can add it to the data model. And then one more time, we select the sales data and we add it to the data model as well. Now let's stop and understand what all has happened. So if you notice, we have the three dimension tables, budget, category, and the name. And we also have the sales data set with us. Now we can click on the diagram view and we can see that we have all the four tables right now. Because the sales data is a transactional data, I'll keep that in the center so that we can create a star schema. And we want to now create relationships. So our customer ID is the same as customer ID. So just click and drag. This will create a one to many relationship, which means that in the dimension table, every customer ID is unique, but that one customer might have purchased numerous times in the sales data set. Similarly, our category can be connected to category, or rather our subcategory can be connected to subcategory. But if you think about it, we don't really need to do it because we've already done the merge. But if you wanted to, you could have selected the subcategory and then put it on the subcategory. And then here we want to select the month and then connect it to the new column that we created, which is the start of the month. Excellent. So as you can see, we have these three relationships now. We have customer ID, we have the subcategory, and we have the month and the start of the month. To make a pivot table, which is a combined pivot table accommodating all these four different tables in it, click on pivot table and then insert a pivot table. Let's put it on a new worksheet. And now you would notice that on the right side, it would show you dimension budget, dimension category, dimension name, fact sales, and dimension target. Wonderful, right? So we can see all the data together. So to see how it works, let me just call this my pivot. If we select our sales value, and we then put, let us say, our month and our budget. Amazing, right? This shows you that for the first of, or rather the month of January 2013, the total sales were 14,000 and the budget was 15,000. So we were actually a little behind our budget. Similarly, for the month of March, budget was 50, the actual sales were 55, so we were ahead of the target. Excellent, right? Let me also show you how you can do simple calculations inside pivot tables. We want to find the difference between the sales and the budget. Let me first remove the decimal places. We click on Power Pivot. We select Measures and then select New Measure. On this, we can call this our difference, and we can put this as the sum of our value minus the sum of our sales amount. Remember, we are not using Excel formulas here. These are DAX expressions, which are data analysis expressions. To quickly show you what these are, we have an expression language called DAX, and this is used to handle specifically data models. How does it work? It works using formulas and expressions, and it works on Power BI, SQL Server Analysis Services, as well as Power Pivot on Excel. The internal engine in all three remain the same, which is the Tableau engine. There are similarities to Excel. There are certain functions that are the same as Excel. For example, you have the count and the count A function, but there are a lot of other differences as well. Fundamentally, DAX is much more powerful than what Excel is able to perform. Once we write the measure, you notice that we get an FX button here in the pivot table field. And this tells us that the difference between 15,000 and 14,000 is 763. As a matter of fact, let me just edit the measure, because this should be, okay, we don't want to create a new one. We just want to edit it. This should actually be the other way around. Okay, so we want to write the actual minus the budget, and this would tell us that there was a shortfall of 763 and there was, you know, an increase over budget of 5,600. If you want to highlight this a little better, we can also select conditional formatting. So home, conditional formatting, and then data bar. And I can see my performance for every month like this. So I can see in how many months I crossed the budget and in how many months I had a shortfall compared to the budget. Excellent. So let's just recap what all we have done. We used Power Query to connect to a folder, append all the files, do some merge. We also created fact and dimension tables. After that, we put all these tables on the data model so that we can use Power Pivot to create a relationship. And finally, we have managed to create a combined pivot table, which has allowed us to select any column from any one of these tables. So if you notice, if I select category and I put it in the slicer, so if we go to pivot table analyze, and we insert a slicer for my category, you would notice that despite the fact that all of this data is coming from three separate tables, remember? So we have category coming from one table, we have the budget coming from a different table, and we have the sales coming from a yet another table. You notice that when I click, I can actually see all of these are connected to each other. Now do remember, right now the result will not be 100% correct, because The difference actually is still showing you the budget for all the three categories. Since our data does not have the budget for different categories individually, of course, all of these are going to be shown as losses. For example, our total achievement was 14,237, but when I click on furniture, it tells me my total achievement is 6,200. But obviously, my budget was only one consolidated budget for all the three categories. So don't worry about the result. The reason I wanted to show this to you is to tell you that we can have multiple tables all handshaking and talking to each other. So far, we have done Power Query, we have done Power Pivot. Let me make a new pivot table now, and we can start working with some fundamentals of pivoting and dashboarding. So we click on Insert and then Pivot Table. Now you might be wondering why I have not selected a data set. The reason I don't need to select a data set is because I already have the option, which is a data model. So I will use the workbook's data model. And when I click on OK, you notice that I can immediately create a pivot table that has all the five tables in it. Okay, so let's start with the basic pivot table. We want to put our sales value in values. That gives us 22,97,200. Let me hide the decimal place. And if we put our region in rows, we will get Central East, South and West, and the four sales value. Let me add one more element. Let me add the category as well. Now, there are different ways of presenting this data. At the top, you have the Design tab, and on this, you can change the report layout. And you have three different options available. We have the current one, which is the compact form, we have the outline form, and we have the tabular form. Now, right now, you might not notice a lot of difference. There's just a very minor difference that happens. But if you put your category in rows, then you will see a very big difference. Let's look at it once again. In the compact form, we have our two rows, region and category, in a single column. If I click on the drop-down, then I will also get the option to select the field that I want to sort. If we select the outline form, it's very similar, but now you get two columns. And finally, when you select the tabular form, it becomes like this. Personally, I like to use the tabular form, but there is nothing right or wrong here. I will leave that decision up to you. If you want to fill up these blank values, you can click on the report layout and select repeat all item labels. Then you also have some options for subtotals. So you can show all the subtotals, which can either be at the bottom or at the top. Then you also have the option to hide all those subtotals. Similarly, you have an option to hide all the grand totals as well, like this. For now, I want to keep that. In pivot table style options, we can either select the column headers as a slightly different font, and similarly for the row headers as well. We also have banded rows and banded columns that basically gives me alternate colors. That gives me colors for alternate rows and columns. In pivot table styles, we have many, many different styles available. If you want to create a style of your own, that is also possible. You can click on New Pivot Table Style, and you can literally have a very nuanced approach to defining every single element in the pivot table that you want. For now, let me go back to the way it originally was. Then in Pivot Table Analyze, you can hide the field headers like this. You might be wondering why are we doing this, but there are certain cases wherein you don't want to show it, perhaps because you want to keep one of your own, and this is how you hide the field header. Remember, you will not be able to delete it. Pivot tables don't allow you to delete them. But if you want to rename it, it is possible. So for example, if I want to call this my region, I can do that. If I want to call this category, or let's say my category, I can do that. All right. You have the pivot table fields option. If you click on the gear icon, you can click on sort A to Z or sort in data source order. So when I select A to Z, you would see that all the columns are appearing in an alphabetical order. And obviously, if you choose data source order, then you will get the original order in which the data was present. You can also drag out this entire pane and you can keep it as a floating window on your screen, which means that you can keep it wherever you want. You can either keep it on the left side or on the right side, or you can detach it and keep it like a floating window like this. If you close it and you want to bring it back, you click on the field list button. This will help you toggle between the field list being shown or not shown. There are also options to change the way filter column rows and values are shown. So you have these different layouts available. But personally, I haven't really seen the value in changing these. Perhaps you might like it. Like this one, I like to use sometimes when I have a very large number of columns. So I like to use field section and area section side by side like this. But for now, I'll change it to the default, which is this one. Okay. By default, whenever you put a number in the value, you get a sum, like we are able to see the sum of sales. But if I put the customer name, so if I put my customer name in the value, because Pivot will not be able to sum it up, it by default shows me the count like this. Okay. Once we've done this, we can also see there are different types of summaries available. So we can summarize it by sum, count, average, max, and min. So count will show us the number of transactions. So 481, 1422, so on and so forth. Similarly, we have the average that shows us the average of every single transaction, or rather the average of all the transactions. So let's copy the pivot. We can simply select it, Control C and then Control V. Do remember that every pivot that you create will have a different name. So my first pivot is called pivot table file. If you want to change it, you can call it my one, and you can call the second one my two. The names don't really have a lot of significance unless you're working with a very large number of pivot tables, but it's good to know because when you're working with Visual Basic programming, then you might have to keep a check on which pivot tables you're working on. I want to keep all my subcategories and the sales value. And I just will copy this a few times. All right. To sort the data, you can right click, sort largest to smallest, smallest to largest. If you try to apply a filter on column C, it will not permit you. So when you click on data, you would see that the filter button is deactivated. But if you click on the column right outside the pivot table, the button is visible. And when you click on it, now you will get a filter inside the pivot table. It's a small trick, but you have to remember this. Now let's say you want to compare one particular subcategory versus all the others. So we can right click, let us say on bookcases, select show values as difference from or percentage difference from. So when I click on difference from, it basically shows me the difference of all subcategories versus bookcases like this. And now if we apply a conditional formatting, which is my data bar, we would get a result like this. So very clearly we can see how many categories, or rather how many subcategories, are doing better than bookcases versus the ones that are not doing better than it. Just like this, you also have the option to click on percentage difference from. This will give you the same result as a percentage. So right now I'm comparing everything to accessories, and I can see some of them are higher, some of them are lower than accessories. Let's look at one more example. So we will keep our sales value one more time in values. On the first one, we can, or rather on the second one, we can right click and show the values as percentage of column total. So that will basically tell us the percentage contribution of each subcategory. We can also show the values as running total. That will give us a cumulative like this. So we can see accessories is 167, appliances plus accessories is 274, the top three are 302. Why is it important? Because when you select the percentage of running total, this would allow you to do a Pareto analysis or an ABC analysis. And if I sort the data largest to smallest, you would see that out of the 17 subcategories that we have, our top 8 are contributing nearly 80% to my total business, while the other 9 are contributing only 22% to my total business. We can also select percentage of. In percentage of, we can choose any subcategory. Let's say we're choosing chairs. So it will tell me that chairs is the base item, which is 100%, and bookcases is 34% of chairs. This can also be a very important analysis. Okay, let's make one more pivot. I'll just scroll down and paste it here. I want to remove my subcategory and we want to keep our dates in it. So I'll keep my order date. Now you would notice that the order date is coming as an individual date from January 13 till December 16. If you want to group it, simply right click and group. And you can select month, quarter and years. And now you can see the data grouped like this. Month, quarter and year. If you change the design to a compact form, then everything will appear in one single column, or you can put it in a tabular form which appears like this. So let's say you want to look at seasonality. So I will remove the quarter and we will also remove the date, and we will keep the year in our column so we can see the 12 months and the 4 years like this. To make a chart, click on Pivot Table Analyze and select Pivot Chart. The shortcut is Alt F1, the function key. This will create a pivot chart for you. But rather than showing a chart like this, I would prefer to select a line chart so I can see the seasonality like this. So we are able to see a different trend line for every single year, and we can see the movement for all the 12 months like this. Okay, let's also look at some month over month calculations. So if you right click and then show the values as percentage difference from, They can choose the base item as not a specific month, but the previous month. And this would allow us to see how many months have we shown a growth over the previous month and how many months have we shown a degrowth. To highlight it even better, we can select, and then on conditional formatting, I will apply two highlight rules. One is greater than 0%. So anything greater than 0% should be green. And then once again, anything lesser than 0% should be red. Let's just change the column width. And this would be a very nice way of presenting the data. So in one glance, you can see how many months there has been a growth and in how many months there has been a degrowth. Let's make a slicer. So on Pivot Table Analyze, we can insert a slicer. And I can insert a slicer for, let's say, my category. Now you notice that every time you make an action, or rather perform an action, the column width keeps on changing. You can suppress it if you want to. So right click and click on Pivot Table Options and deselect this option called Auto Fit Column Widths on Update. This would mean that if you notice, if I keep a width of 10, every time I select a category, the width remains constant. It is not auto updating, which is a good thing, like this. Let's also find who the top 10 customers are. So we will keep our customer name in rows. Let me make sure that I've removed the calculation and all of these are numbers. Okay. To sort the data, we already know we can right click and then sort it as largest to smallest. Now, if you want to see the top 10 customer, select the name filter, click on value filter, and then select top 10. You can choose between a top and a bottom, and you can also choose the number that you want to see. So if you only want to see the top 5, we can select top 5, and it will show us the top 5 customers like this. Once you have created a pivot, and if you want to remove everything from the pivot, you can go to Pivot Table Analyze, click on Clear, and then click on Clear All. This will remove every single field that you have kept inside the pivot. Also, if you want to move it to a different sheet, you can click on Move Pivot Table, and you can move it to a different location on the same sheet, or you can move it to a different worksheet. Let's also look at a heat map. So I will copy this and let's put it slightly differently. So I want to keep my month in columns and we want to keep our subcategory in our rows like this. So let me make sure that there are no calculations here. So show values as no calculation. And we might want to decrease the column width a little bit. So let's try a 7. Yeah, I think that looks okay. Let's align everything in the center. Perfect. Now what we want to do is to create a heat map. A heat map is something like this. This is used by all consulting firms and professional services firms. It's a very common visualization. It's a staple that everybody creates. Heat maps can be like this, or it can be in the form of a table. And you can even have multiple colors, or maybe two colors or three colors, or a monochromatic heat map like this. So I'll create a simple one. We will select all the numbers except the grand total for the row and the column. And we can click on conditional formatting and color schemes. And we can create a heat map like this. So the larger numbers are, so let me select the first one. So the larger numbers are green and the smaller numbers are red. If you want to hide all the numbers, you can right click, format cells, and then click on custom and change the type to 3 semicolons. That will hide all the numbers and you can only see the heat map like this. And remember, you do have a slicer here. So if I put the slicer, you would notice that every time I select a slicer, we're able to see a different result on the heat map, right? So it looks really nice. Okay, let's also look at the timeline now. Just like the slicer, we also have a timeline option. The timeline allows us to choose an order date. And this means that I can see the top five customers maybe for only 1 year. So if I want to see the top five for 16, I can do that. If I want to see the top five for 15 and 16, I can do that. And if I only want to see the top five for, let's say, the last 3 quarters, I can do that as well, like this. Even on the timeline and the slicer, we have options to change the colors. So not a lot of options, but just some basic color changes that you're able to make. So we make one more pivot. I will keep my category and let's say our region in columns. We'll remove all the calculations and make sure that all of these are numbers. Perfect. Let's also hide the decimal place. Let us look at get pivot data. To enable it, you have to click on Pivot Table Analyze, then click on the small drop down next to options, and then ensure that the Generate Get Pivot Data button has been enabled, like this. So there should be a tick mark next to this. When you do this, you would notice that if I write equal to and I write G159, then it selects G159. But if I select the cell directly, it will write something like this for me. Now, I know this looks a little complicated, but let's break it down into different steps and understand how this is working. So my get pivot data has the data field, which is my sales value. Then I have the pivot table, which simply tells me the cell where the pivot table is starting. Then it gives me pairs of field and item. So I have field item, field item, field item. So if you notice, my field and item is like this, and my field and item is like this, which means that category is my field and this is the item, which is furniture. Region is my field, and then this is the item, which is the West region. Now, this is very handy because when you're working with get pivot data, this means that even if your pivot layout is changing, this will still continue to give you the correct result. For example, notice this number 64894. Even if I put my region in rows, despite that fact that it's 64894 is not in the same cell, it has moved to a different cell, which is E161, the result is still coming because it is able to track the value that you have assigned. So I won't cover this in detail, but I hope you can understand that from a modeling perspective, this might really help you, because when you're working with multiple pivots and multiple sheets and workbooks, and you have calculations attached to the pivot tables, it is very handy, because when you use get pivot data, since the pivot by nature is dynamic, the formulas will also become dynamic. So do practice this quite a lot. All right, let's also look at sparklines. So I'll keep my, let's remove everything. In fact, I can just select one of the pivots that we had created earlier, which is this one. So if I want to create a sparkline, we can just select a blank cell, click on insert and then sparkline line. And in this, the data range would be the 12 months that we have. And you notice we get a very nice spark line inside the cell like this. So see, it's not very detailed. It's not going to replace a normal chart, but it's very nice for a quick understanding of the peaks and the troughs. So one other very important thing I wanted to show you was how you can do grouping without dates. So I want to select my subcategory and my sales value. So we'll keep it simple. My sales, which is here. All right. So imagine you want to show the data in a sorted manner, which we can do. And you notice there are a lot of them that are less than 10,000. And you don't really want to focus on them. So what you can do is to select the last five, right click and then group them. And it says that I can't group it. Okay, that's strange. Let me quickly see why this is not working. Okay, let's try that once again. So we have selected these five and for some reason it is not allowed to group it. No problem. Let me try and see if I can select my subcategory from the sales table and not from the category table. Okay, and it still doesn't work. Okay, that's very peculiar. Let me see if we can probably put it on a different sheet and then try to do it. Hold on. So we can select and then group it. Okay, for some reason it's not working, but that's okay. I'll still show you the process in a different example. So from my original sales data, we just want to make a pivot table. And here I will put my subcategory in rows and we'll put our sales value in values. We want to first sort the data. And then we want to select the last five and then group it. So might be some reason that because of the model, I was not able to do it earlier, but this is how it works. So you notice this group is my less than 10,000. Now we can click on this expand or collapse button. So if I click on collapse, then it shows me all the subcategories like this. So it is telling me that if I sort the data now, phones, chairs, storage is number one, number two, number three. But if I combine all the subcategories that are less than 10,000, then they add up to become 105779 like this. If you want to ungroup it, simply click on any cell, click on ungroup, and then you can ungroup the data. Let me try that once again. So you can click on ungroup and you'll be able to ungroup the data like this. All right. The next thing that I want to show you is how you can connect to a data set from the internet. So let's say we want to look at the population of all these states. So I'm putting my state in my rows, and we also want to see the population for each of these states in the United States. So let's quickly Google it. So we go to US state population. On Wikipedia, you can see we have a table that gives us a list of all the states and the population as well. The estimated one for 2019. We can copy the URL, come back to Excel. On data, we will select from web, paste the URL and click on OK. So what will happen is that Excel using Power Query will go to the website and will now populate a list of all the tables that are available on the website. So if I scroll, I will see that this is the table that has a list of all the states as well as the population. We click on transform data. Let's remove everything that we don't require. So we only need the state and we need the 2019 population. So we can remove all the other, I'm sorry, we have to remove all the other columns. So we select state and then population and we remove all the other columns. Let's call this query as dim and population. We also want to remove the first row because that doesn't really make any sense. So this is the state, this is my population, and to remove the top row, in remove rows, we will select remove top rows, and we can remove the number one row like this. Close and load. A new sheet is created, and let's call this my population. We want to add it to the data model, so Power Pivot and add it to the data model. Then we have done this earlier, right? So we click on Manage. Diagram view, and we can connect our state to our state, and we can create a relationship. Now, when we make a pivot table, so I'm just going to make a fresh one on a new worksheet. We can put our state in rows. We can put our, let's say, our profit value in values, and we can put our population in values. And very nicely, okay, for some reason it's not working. It's showing us the count of population. That is strange. Okay, let me go back to Power Query and double check this. So we launch the Power Query editor. And on the population, okay, if you notice, this is showing as a text value. That's why the problem was occurring. We have to make sure to change it to a whole number. And it says there are some errors, is it? Let's see. So there are some errors at the bottom. Okay. So we want to remove these errors, right? So right click and we want to remove all the errors and then click on close and load once again. Let's see if it works now. So if I refresh my pivot table, it is still not working. Okay. Let's see once. Let's try to change it to a sum. And it is not showing you the sum for the state even now. Okay, no problem. But this is fixable. So we are not getting the correct population for all the states. So we can remove the state and we have to make sure to select the state from our population table. And once we do that, okay, we can see the results like this. Now remember, the logic that we are selecting the population from the state is because this is a one-to-many relationship and the population table has all the states mentioned one unique time. Now you would see that the profit for some of the states are missing, but that is expected to happen because there are certain states where we don't have a presence. So while we do have a population, we don't have a profit for that particular state. But I hope you saw how very nicely now we are able to create a model that is doing a number of different things. We are able to connect different tables with each other, and we're also able to essentially take a data set from the internet and then add it to the same model that we have. So I know we have done the calculations earlier, but I want to do one more example for the measure. So let's say you want to take your sales value. And let me remove the profit. And what we want to do is to understand what is the per capita sales amount, right? I know the number is going to be really small, but it will still act as an index number So it will still enable us to do some comparison between all the states. So we click on measure and then new measure. We call this per capita sales index. And this would be the sum of my, so this would be the sum. Okay, so when we calculate the per capita, we typically look at the total earning divided by the population. So we look at the total sales amount divided by my population. And this would give us some numbers here. Now remember, I know these numbers are very small, but the idea of doing this, let me just make them all a little lesser in decimal places. We're not able to do that. Just hold on. That's okay. We can still look at it like this. So we will first apply a filter, then I'll sort it largest to smallest, and you would see that Delaware, Rhode Island, Washington, New York, Vermont, California, Pennsylvania. Like this, we're able to see that in terms of a per capita sales index, these are the states where the per capita sales index is the highest, right? Which means that it's a good sign because this shows you that you're selling more per resident in that particular state. If you want to see the measures that you have created, you can go to Pivot Table Analyzer. Sorry, you click on Power Pivot, click on Measures, and then Manage Measures, and you can see the data like this. If I put my region in the filter, we can now click on Pivot Table Analyze, the drop down next to Options, and then select Show Report Filter Pages. So you notice we have an option here called Show Report Filter Pages. Now do remember that there are, when you make a model, there are certain cases where this option might not be enabled. For example, we can't see this right now. So don't worry about it. It's a very useful option and I will show you how to work with it. But just remember that in the case of a model, it might not work properly. So let's go back to our sales data set. So we have our sales data. I'll just create a simple pivot table. We will keep our region in filters, our sales value in values, and our state in state. What that does is that now when I click on the drop down, we have an option called Report Filter Pages, and this will allow us to click on OK. And you notice it has created one single worksheet for every single region. So we have one sheet for central, one for east, one for south, and one for west, like this. Even if you have 100 different items that are there in the report filter, you can essentially create 100 different worksheets in a single click. The model that we have created will also work on Power BI. So we can import the entire Power Pivot model that we have created on Excel. So let me open Power BI Desktop to show you how this would work. So we click on File and then Import. Select Power Query, Power Pivot, Power View. We can select our file. Remember, the Excel file has to be closed for this to work. Okay, let's look at the warnings that are there. So it says that maximum size. Okay, I'll have to go back and double check on that. But anyway, what you would see here is that we have managed to import all the tables that we have, but you notice that the models are not coming properly, right? So the relationship is not coming properly. Also, the count of name, the count of population, sum of population is coming differently. So it doesn't work seamlessly There are things that you can do about it, which means that you will have to make sure that the Excel model that you're creating has been done in such a way that you are enabling Power BI to understand it. But here, if you notice per capita sales index, it is not able to understand what it is. If I click on transform data, it will show me that we have different dimensions. So we have our fact table. If I go to transform and then statistics and then count values, it tells me 9,994 rows. So all the values have been picked up. If I go to these, I can again see my data set, right? Let me click on close and apply. But you notice the relationships are not coming automatically, right? There are reasons for this. One reason is that how Power Query understands data types is very different from Excel. For example, if you look at, let's say the budget, this is not a date. This is a date and time value. So we have two options here, a date time and a date. If I convert it to a date, then it doesn't allow me because it tells me that there is some problem with the way this data has been represented, right? So the reason I wanted to show this to you is to tell you that while you can import a model created on Excel on Power BI, it's not that seamless a process. There are lots and lots of checks and balances that you will have to keep in place. But as long as you're doing that properly on Excel, you will be able to import it. Maybe not 100%, but 70-80% on Power BI. That might help you save a lot of time. So everyone that completes our video on Power Pivot and Power Query, I hope you liked the video. We covered quite a lot of topics here. In addition to showing you the types of calculations and summaries available inside a pivot, we also saw something much more important, which is how using Power Query, we can append our data, we can get data from the internet, we can do a merge, and we can also use column from example. So that's the machine learning bit that we're using to clean the data. In Power Pivot, we saw how we can create a measure, which is basically the same thing as my calculations. We can also create relationships between different tables. Together, Power Query and Power Pivot are very, very, very important. And if used well, they can have a huge impact on the automation that you do in your projects. Once again, thank you, everybody. If you're interested, there are a few courses that I have available. So you can simply go to this link. So this is havishramconsulting.stores.instamojo.com. And on this, you will be able to find a list of all the courses that I have available. So I have courses on Power BI, which is a 5-hour course, a 3-hour course on Tableau, a 3-hour course on PowerPoint. Then I have some courses on Python as well. These are very basic courses for absolute beginners. Then there are a lot of courses I have on Excel. So these range from 1 hour to 3 hours each. So Visual Basic, Dynamic Arrays, VLOOKUP, Pivot Tables, Financial Formulas, Data Clearing, Data Wrangling, Power Query, Excel Charts, and Date Functions. I keep on adding the content in all these courses. And if you want to buy the entire bundle, you can always drop me a line on my email and I will be more than happy to offer a discount to you in case you want to do a bulk purchase. All the very best, everyone.